you are familiar with our constitution, if you look at the constitution, the vice president doesn't have real powers except to wait for something to happen to the president. Parang sayang yata yung 6 years na naging time tayo. When I looked at the budget, over the years, ganun nga, yun nangyayari. Most of the budget, the office of the vice president has one of the smallest budgets for departments of government. The bulk of the budget of vice presidency is much smaller, not a very small part. So we want that to happen. Is it less vice president, not the office of the vice president, into something is more vocabulary. Pero lang pero doon. Ang gusto ko din budget lang talaga. We started doing budgetary savings measures already, and we started moving on from the Palas to New Manila. The rent of the Coconut Palas before the GSIS was a little less than 500,000 pesos. I think 480 pesos. And he found us to save at least 200,000 every month. So gusto namin parang we're still asking from DBM if we can use the savings in more advocacy work. As we really started better, even in relation, we started working on it. And we sort of try to assess what kinds of advocacy can be. We decided on 5 core areas. The second was the third one was the issue of rural development. The one was the theme ng convention. I am sure you are aware that by the president before inauguration, he didn't intend to give me any cabinet post. So we were sort of preparing for that. Sabi ko, di ba na pwede na akong gagawin 6 years. So we planned already. The staff was suggesting, let's add housing as one of our books. Years, because that's been my advocacy when I was really heavy with the voters. That's also my the advocacy of my last one. Pero sa kanila, kung tayo mag-amit sa housing, kasi without government support, we can never push for advocacy. Pa-provincial naman, kasi nakakata naman for advocacy areas, the housing support for offered to me. So it's like a sex because constraints are not law projects. So what we have now is sort of in house of all private organizations who are all these 5 ginagawa namin ngayon, Mondays to Thursdays, na the organization foundations, and trying to do exactly that, doing programs under the food drug is a lot of activities, the children, and some of the embassy, and then we try to make a list of ano yung mga areas at mga matatang sa atin na mataas na siya. I think covered was that while there are so many organizations we have of people, parang yung pronouns ang pinaka accomplishment niya is how many children are there. So if you look, we look at the accomplishments of these private organizations, parati sinasabi nila, this year we fed 20,000 children. So again, it's like our office will try to help change the mindset. But feeding is not the end all of these programs. Dapat measurable. So with regards to the first advocacy, hunger and food security, we plan to do a nutrition governance program where we help everyone start with baselines, do feeding, and then make it measurable, make all the efforts measurable. We are also trying to inculcate the belief that hunger, malnutrition cannot be solved by feeding alone. Mm-hmm. It has to be feeding and poverty. Because even if you feed, but the number of poor families are also increasing, then the malnutrition stats won't ever go down. So yun po yung tulong namin, kami yung magbibigay ng technical assistance, how these private organizations can improve their existing programs and then match them with beneficiaries. So Mondays to Thursdays, that's what we're doing. But Fridays and Saturdays, that's our, we call this Laylayan trips. Laylayan trips because these are the days that we go to the poorest barangays, the farthest, the smallest, the poorest barangays. We're concentrating now on the 20 poorest provinces. So far, we've visited 6 already in the first month. By visiting them, we try to assess what are the circumstances. Why do they think are they included in the 20 poorest provinces? Kasi iba naman yung dahilan. So, kung ano yung mga nalalaman namin, it's all sort of a listening trip. Hindi kami yung nagsasalita, kami yung nakikinig. So, ginagawa na profile the places we visit and we try to link them up with the supply side. So, ngayon, our first month in office has been very fruitful. We're far from our target. We're still on the stage of scanning the environment, but starting August 15, we're going to summit and conferences already. Because we're going to have one big summit in September 22. We're going to have one summit already of the roadmap. Mm-hmm. Parang ang ayaw naming mangyari, tira lang ng tira na walang plano. Kasi baka maraming nasasayang na resources. So we will try to dream together, we will try to plan together, but we will make sure that our targets are delivered. And we want to make sure that every resource that comes in would be measured. Mahirap kasi yung labas ng pera tapos hindi naman na-translate. So we're sort of changing mindsets. As I have said, we will not receive donations. Our office do not want to receive donations. What we will do is just link the private organizations with the beneficiaries. So, mga private organizations, diretso sila sa beneficiaries, but we help them every stage of the way, every step of the way. So, yun, kami yung magsasekretariat, kami yung clearinghouse, but we will be with them every step of the way. I think it's doable, considering the many limitations of my office. As I've said, under the Constitution, we don't have a mandate to execute execute programs. But I think we can be a very good conduit, be an inspiration for. Alam niyo po, siguro you're familiar naman with sa atin kasi required yung mga corporate social responsibility programs of all the companies. And maraming companies yung naghahanap ng CSR programs but don't really know what to do. So kami yun, we plan to give a menu already. Here are the things needed. But if you will give, this is how we will measure everything and these are the targets. Ano naman, we're very excited. we think we will be able to do much, but we really need the support of everyone. Kaya my coming over is also an opportunity to inspire everyone to be involved. Even if the Filipino Americans here are so far away from home, it doesn't keep them from being engaged. All we can do perhaps is make it easy for them to help our clients pave the way so that they will be able to engage in a manner that is most convenient for everyone.
Thank you, Vice President. The Vice President will be proceeding to her next event, so unfortunately I'll be reading the last question. Okay, unfortunately, the Vice President has a tight schedule, so we apologize for that. So for the last question, I wish to read from Rochelle Ocampo, Makilala TV. This is in relation to the younger generation Filipino-American leaders who want to be more involved in business and entrepreneurial opportunities in the Philippines. What is your administration or planning to elevate and support PhilAMs to strengthen the economy of the Philippines?
I will try to dissect that question kasi parang there are two parts, di ba? Yung first part is I think more in line with what we're doing now. As I have said earlier, there are just too many of us who are willing to help. Ang pinaka-question lang, they do not know how. Ang second question, the matter of trust. Gusto ng Pangulo, pero how can we be assured that our help will reach those that we want to help? Diba? So since the premise of the question is young Filipino-Americans, and by young, siguro hindi naman yung edad ko na mga 20s, 30s. We have, I think, been living here for the longest time. Most of them have been were born here already. Siguro it would be a tremendous help kung magkaroon ng mga trips na sinusponsor for them. There is one program now, I forgot the name of it. I think it has to be expanded. There is an ongoing program now. What they do is that government organizes trips for the young people. Parang internship pero mas pinapakilala yung pinanggalingan. Pero I think it has to be enhanced in a way na hindi lang siya mas culture, hindi lang siya mas history. Pero a large part of it will also be opening their eyes to the situation in the Philippines, giving them an opportunity to understand what is happening back home. But at the same time, paving the way for them to guide them how they can be of help. Marami kasing problema sa atin ngayon, gustong tumulong, pero maraming the bureaucracy is really too much. Marami sa atin, I don't know if you have heard stories already, magpapadala ng mga used medical equipment, tapos tatagayin sa customs. Magpapadala ng mga libro, tatagayin sa customs. So I think that has to be, parang it has to be, bureaucratic red tape has to go. I think the president is very supportive as far as this is concerned. We have talked about this already during our cabinet meetings. How do we make our processes more customer friendly? Pag gustong tumulong ng mga taga dito, paano ba siya mapapadali? Sa atin kasi pupunta, pag umuwi, marami pang horror stories na nasasalubong. So ito, we propose that there should be an interagency task force who will try to go over ano ba yung mga proseso nandyan, paano mai-improve yung mga proseso. Interagency task force na dapat nandyan yung DTI, nandyan yung DOT, nandyan yung DSWD. Right now, the past administration has made several headways already Pero yung bureaucratic red tape talaga yung kailangan pang asikasuhin. It has to be easy enough. Example, sa housing, right now we're trying to set up a one-stop shop for doing this. There are a lot of companies I discovered who are just too willing to go into socialized housing. Pero para pumasok sa socialized housing, ikaw na yung gustong tumulong, pero pinapahirapan ka pa sa proseso. In the same manner na yung mga mahihirap gusto mag-apply ng pabahay, ilang taon bago na-approve. So, ang sa amin, if we can do everything in a few days only, better. Alam ko kayong lahat na andito gustong tumulong. Ano lang, yung alinlangan lang. Di ba? Maraming pag-aalinlangan. Yung less Filipino worker always has an urge to give back. Mm-hmm. Hindi lang sa pamilya, pero sa yung pag-give back na kahit tumulong sa isang kababayan na nangangailangan. Pero always, there is a sort of an anxiety to help in the sense that you are not really sure if your help will reach the person you want to help. So, maraming bagay na ganun. Just the last point already. I don't think this is Filipinos in the United States, since most of the Filipinos here are professionals. Pero yung mga OFWs in other countries, in Naga, where I come from, in Naga City, we have established the very first migrant resource center. We established that last year. That's the first and only thing in the Philippines right now. But what we're doing is, yung migrant center na is doing everything for people who want to work abroad and for people who are already working abroad. Merong pre-deployment, merong deployment, and post-deployment. I think this will be very helpful in the sense that, halimbawa, yung mga andito, mga tatanda na gusto nang mag-retire sa Pilipinas, ayaw umuwi kasi hindi alam kung ano yung opportunities doon. This migrant resource center will take care of everything. Yun naman pre-deployment, yung magusto magtrabaho para hindi siya naloloko ng mga employment agencies, yung gobyerno ang nagpo-process ng lahat. We have been doing that for almost a year already in Naga. It has been cited internationally already by different organizations. I hope to advocate that as well in many other parts of the Philippines. Kasi I am sure marami dito na gusto na mag-retire. Ayaw naman sa Amerika mag-retire kasi mas masaya sa Pilipinas. Pero hindi alam ko ano yung mapupuntahan. This migrant resource center would be to do that. Yung itarang mo, related din dun kasi the same center can provide a wealth of resources for young Filipino Americans who want to do business in the Philippines, who want to help in any way they could.
Thank you, Madam Vice President. On behalf of the Filipino community and the Philippine Consulate General in New York, Madam Vice President, we'd like to thank you for granting us the opportunity to engage your office and for the explanation about your programs. On behalf of the Philippine media, Philippine American media and press, wish to convey our wholehearted support to your programs. When you come back, we wish to engage you more, and I'm sure a lot of press members will be interested to talk to you. Again, maraming salamat. With this, we wish to end the program. Okay.
I'm sorry, I just have to ask. I apologize for having pushed this last question because the Philippines was featured in the New York Times recently and Washington Post about the extrajudicial killings, drug-related. We just wanted to get your thoughts on this. Are you in favor of this? What can you do as Vice President?
Am I in favor of?
I think
I've been very vocal about it. In fact, I have issued several official statements already. But you know, I'm just one voice. Even if I am vice president, I'm just one voice. I think media can start as creating you know, a mindset that this is not right. There has been a few voices already out there against extrajudicial killings, but I think the public outcry is not enough. It's not just there yet. I think all of us should do our share in making sure that you know, this has to stop. The president has made several statements already saying that the rule of law and due process would be honored. But you know, every one of us should have a stake in this. Just last week, I lost two of my friends. One is a barangay captain, one is a sheriff, to senseless deaths. I was in the wake of, I don't know if you read about him, the high school teacher who was a batchmate of my second daughter, high school math teacher in Ateneo, who was gunned down, Pavia, who was gunned down outside his house, and until now, no leads. And the barangay captain I was telling you was aged already. If I am not mistaken, late 60s, early 70s, very simple, very humble man. No enemies. He was also gunned down by motorcycle riding men. Ano eh, parang there is a pervading culture of impunity. Not only that, if you look at social media, it also seems like there is a culture of hatred already. Parang kakaiba ngayon, di ba? Parang, I think this started during the campaign, the campaign period. Parang hindi naman tayo ganito eh. And then, you will ask yourself, ba't tayo? Parang may snap sa atin lahat. But if you will also look at the rest of the world, it seems that we're not alone in this. There is a global phenomenon right now, no? Now, there is really a culture of hatred going around. Pero we don't feel helpless, eh. It's scary. Ito, pag hindi kasi enough yung public outcry, that brings a sense of hopelessness. And you ask yourself, is this really what the majority wants? Bakit pa lang ganun? So, tatanungin natin yung sarili natin, ito ba yung gusto natin? Kasi kung ito yung gusto natin, yung mga ayaw nun, talagang dapat matakot. Pero kung hindi naman ito yung gusto natin, pero marami lang sa atin hindi bumoboses, then we're not doing enough. So, ako naman, I've been very vocal about it. A few other people have been very, very vocal about it, pero our voices are not enough eh. We should be more. Para yung pressure na medyo kakaiba. Tama po kayo. It's scary in the sense na maraming nangyayari pero konti yung
Madam Vice President.
Thank you everyone. With that, we wish to end the formal proceedings of this press conference. To our friends in the press and media practitioners, we wish to thank you. Maraming salamat po. The Vice President will be attending the next few events, so there's still an opportunity to meet her. Maraming salamat po at magandang hapon.